do. And great, I feel like a jazz musician. I want to thank our hosts for this evening in this great place. And I noticed on the way in that there was an oil portrait of Charles Bukowski. And then about halfway, two-thirds of the way through the room, there's a hung down low is an oil portrait of Yeats. Now, think about how many portraits of poets are there on, let's say, the East Coast? How many portraits of poets are there in New Jersey? And how many of them are in this room? So this is it's a treasure for our culture. And it's great to be here. And I'm curious how many people here are from my new employer, Rutgers. How many people are in my poetry workshop who are here? Who's in my poetry workshop? All right, great. Come say hello afterward. I am joining the faculty at Rutgers this fall, and I couldn't be more pleased about it. So I am going to start out by reading you a few new poems. I was lucky enough to have a guest job at Stanford University earlier this year, and the truth of the matter is that I didn't really work very hard, and so I had some time to write. So these are experimentally brief poems, and this first one takes its title from a little town near the place where we were living. It's called Pescadero. The little goats like my mouth and fingers. And one stands up against the wire fence and taps on the fence board, a hoof made blacker by the dirt of the field. Pushes her mouth forward to my mouth so that I can see the smallish squared seeds of her teeth and the bristle whiskers. And then she kisses me, though I know it doesn't mean kiss. And leans her head way back, arcing her spine, goat yoga, all pleasure and greeting, and then good-natured indifference. She loves me. She likes me a lot. She takes interest in me. She doesn't know me at all, or need to, having thus acknowledged me. Though I am all happiness, since I have been welcomed by the field's small envoy, a splayed hoof, fragrant with soil, has rested on the fence board beside my hand. So this poem grows out of that experience, which I'm sure many of you have had, which is that of purchasing a used book without looking carefully and discovering that you have brought home someone else's marginal notes, which then forever hold your attention hostage. This happened to me, unfortunately, with a copy of Leaves of Grass. And I turn to section 6 of Some of Myself, which is the great passage which begins, a child said, what is the grass? Fetching it to me with full hands. How could I answer the child? I do not know what it is any more than he. This is called What is the Grass? On the margin, in the used text I've purchased without opening, pale, green, dutiful vessel, some unconvinced student has written in a clear, looping hand. Isn't it grass? How could I answer the child? I do not exaggerate. I think of her question for years. And while first I imagine her the very type of the incurious, revealing the difference between a mind at rest and one that cannot. Later, I come to imagine that she had faith in language. That was the difference. She believed that the word settled things. The matter need not be looked into again. And he who'd written his book over and over, nearly ruining it, so enchanted was he by what had first compelled him, for him, the word settled nothing at all. Oh, thank you. So during this time in the West, I used to like to go to Santa Cruz, California, where you can stand out on a pier in the harbor, and you can watch the sea lions there. And the sea lions like to sort of clump together in these little groups and float on the tide. And it's difficult to tell how many are in such a cluster because they're all twining in and out. It's called perfect repose. Turning so effortlessly, you wouldn't call it that, what they do. Sliding easily over, kind of oscillation on their sides, most of them, floating together in their troop. Perhaps 25 of them just off the pier, though you couldn't count them, the sea lions. They curve around one another, two break away, one joins, the group drifts with the tide. Whose flipper or tail raised to the sun? Whose head lifted out of the green? They lie a little beneath the surface, now and then turning the face up to breathe, which is suddenly how you know they're asleep. Simultaneous, intimate, soft, person, a little wet. And though one coughs now and then, water in the nose, the single thing they make of many, still and always moving, as if air were also a wave, now arrived at the drifting shore of what pronoun? I mean thou. All breathe in again at once. So I realized on this little journey that I really needed a rest. You know, I loved watching these sea lions sleep, and then this other little poem appeared, which is also has to do with that desire. It's called The Selected Foucault. The history of history, spread-eagled on the plaid wool chest of a young man asleep on his back on the grass beside the path, slight beard gleaming a little in the sun. Discourse of the discourse of power, resting his eyes, relieved. Pleasure of setting the book face down. You'll return to the page in a while, but for now cease all progress. Dreaming of what you've read or not, let the book be only a weight pressing, sunlight on wool, your own weight on the unexpected warmth of the grass. Let argument cease. Who has power over a sleeper? A privacy beside the public path. Immanence is the, you know, the theological notion that God is equally present in all things. Immanence. My lover says he likes to ride on the top level of the George Washington Bridge, because then he's closer to his Lord. I say, but isn't God immanent? And he says, that's true too. And I say, well, how can you be any closer then? He enjoys the mystery of contradiction. Light being lifted up. Well, I think the highest level of the bridge is terrifying. I act as though I am brave because I understand that it's beautiful up here, shockingly so. April pouring its gold over the gathered Hudson. But still, I think of Rilke saying beauty's the beginning of a terror we can hardly bear. My friend would say it's the other way around. Terror, the beginning of some radical beauty. And he's happy, while I drive the appalling, crowded lane. And he looks out over the edges, humming a little, entirely pleased. Okay, so one of these new poems, just before, earlier this evening, before we started here, I was talking to a fellow who had been a student of the wonderful science fiction writer and essayist Samuel Delaney, who teaches at Temple University in Philadelphia. Chip Delaney is also a brilliant essayist, and one of his essays is sort of paraphrase in this poem, which has an odd strategy. It begins telling you one story and then stops to tell another. It's called Gates of the Temple.